Welcome to another edition of HorseCenter, everyone. I am Brian Zipse, and as always, I have the excellent pleasure of being joined by my co-host to the East Coast. That's Matt Shifman. How are you today, Matt?
I am good, Brian. How are you? It's good to. We're doing our annual Thistledown special, HorseCenter.
Yeah, Matt. We both have reasons to like this race. I like this race. I always have for some reason, but some of my favorite horses, I wrote them down, see if I can remember them. Smart 10, Broad Brush, Lost Code, Skip Away. More recently, we've seen Brass Hat, Caleb's Posse, IRAP and Gervin threw down a few years ago in a Great Ohio Derby, and of course, Two Fills very recently. So this is a race that I've always liked. Good horses have ran here every year. We're going to Thistledown right now, Matt. Let's take a look at this $500,000 Ohio Derby. Field of 10, and if you're looking at the show right now, you see Catching Freedom there on the left as the headliner, the morning line favorite. But we're going to start from the rail out, sir. Frizzanti, Greg Sacco brings this son of Vino Rosso in with pretty good form.
Yeah, good form. Nice maiden special weight victory. It took a while at Tampa in his seventh try. But since then, he seems to be getting better, seems to be at the top of his form. For my friend Greg Sacco, who is based at Monmouth Park, had a second in an allowance at Parks most recently.
Yeah, he's certainly moving up in class, but sometimes these Vino Rossos, grandson of Curlin, get better as they go. Frizzanti, one you could keep an eye on here, but a tough spot in the Ohio Derby. Number two is Gould's Gold, and I think Gould's Gold is one of the most interesting horses in the race. We see the connection of sire Golden Sense, trainer Kenny McPeak, rider B.J. Hernandez Jr., the same connections and sire as, of course, Mystic Dan, the Kentucky Derby winner. Now, Gould's Gold was 0-2, Matt, as a two-year-old, but I like his races. He didn't come out until late March this year. Six furlong maiden race, he rallied with a rush to get up and win that, and then they put him in two straight. This will be his third straight two-turn stakes race. And he's run well. First, a third at Oaklawn Park. That was, of course, in the, what do they call that? The Bathhouse Row Stakes. And then last time, a very close second in the Sir Barton. So Gould's Gold seems to be a horse moving in the right direction for trainer Kenny McPeak.
Yeah, and I guess nobody's going better than Kenny McPeak right now. You mentioned Mystic Dan, of course. We got to throw Torpedo Anna in there, Gould's Gold. Two good races in stakes. And those were pretty good fields also. That Bathhouse Row the last couple of years has had pretty good fields at Oaklawn Park. And then the second in the Sir Barton on the undercard of the Preak this weekend.
Yeah, I particularly like his second there. But to go from the six furlong maiden to those good two-turn stakes races shows me that Gould's Gold is a horse of some quality. I think this is probably the toughest one yet, but if he keeps moving forward, definitely a horse to watch out for in the Ohio Derby. Matt, Charleston is still a maiden. He gets blinkers on, but he's 0-6. His previous stakes try, he was ninth by 22 lengths in the Southwest behind that horse, Mystic Dan. Hard to jump on Charleston's chances here.
Yeah, that's for sure. In back a few races ago, he got claimed for $75,000 from a maiden race and is actually making his first start for a new trainer also.
Yeah, the next few horses are going to be horses we could say a little bit more about. Starting with the four, Copper Tax. I'm not buying that this is going to be the second choice on the morning, the second choice when they run, but he is the second choice on the morning line. And I get it. The son of Copper Bullet has won four stakes races, two as a two-year-old, two as a three-year-old. He really likes to win. However, in previous races where he's ventured away from the Mid-Atlantic and faced a little bit tougher company, the Remsen, certainly a muddy edition of the Remsen that has proven to be a real key race this year. And then the CMF Davis, his first start this year, he really did nothing. I have a hard time putting making context of copper tax races in Maryland and Delaware as opposed to better races like the Ohio Derby, given his performances in the Remsen and Sam F. Davis. Easy for me to say.
Yeah, that I agree with what you're saying, Brian. And I don't know where he's going to end up in odds, but anytime a horse has got that many victories in their past performances, they're going to take a lot of money at the betting windows, and certainly Copper Tax with 7 wins from 10 starts, Brian. That's an impressive set of past performances. A second place in there only 2 times out of the money, and you alluded to those 2 races. Those were his only 2 stops on the Kentucky Derby trail. Certainly did not do well with any hopes that they had for the Derby. They moved him back home, back to the local track, where, again, he's winning 2 stakes races in a row. They were the prep races at Laurel Park for the Preakness, winning the Tessio and the private terms.
Yeah, and remember, there was thought about Copper Tax running in the Preakness, but they decided on a little bit easier spot here in the Ohio Derby. I'm not sure how much easier it is. I don't think it'll be the second choice. We'll see. Next on the list is Uncle Heavy, and Uncle Heavy, a stakes winner in Pennsylvania, and then he came to New York and won the Withers with a late rush. But his next 2 starts, Matt, didn't give me a great feeling about the good Uncle Heavy here in the Ohio Derby.
Yeah, seems, this kind of story we'll say about a number of horses in this race. That win in the Withers on the Derby trail in New York at Aqueduct was a really good performance going a mile and an eighth distance, the distance of this Ohio Derby for Parks-based trainer Butch Reed. But yeah, then his last 2, Brian, a 5th place in the Wood Memorial and a 6th place in the Preakness, where he really wasn't much of a contender. So here we are, maybe dialing it back a little bit in class in the Ohio Derby. We'll see what we get from Uncle Heavy in here.
Just a little bit. I would almost compare this Ohio Derby in class this year to the Wood Memorial. It doesn't look so bad when you say it 5th in the Wood Memorial, 6th in the Preakness, but really not a factor in either race. Uncle Heavy, Butch Reed, always dangerous. Uncle Heavy, a multiple stakes winner. Can't throw him completely out, but I think I'm going to be looking elsewhere in this field. One horse I probably won't be looking at too heavily is Deposition. Uriah St. Louis pops up every once in a while, Matt, but this son of Constitution is 2 of 11 l5 and 5 stakes tries already. Uriah St. Louis always is not afraid to put his horses into the deep end of the pool. 5 stakes races already. The best he's done is the Withers, where he was 4th, a well-beaten 4th. And I guess as you kind of guessed from what I was saying about Uncle Heavy, I'm not sure how strong that Withers was this year.
Yeah, it's certainly seeming that way. There were much better Derby-related races at Aqueduct than the Withers. But yeah, and continuing, it took 5 tries for Deposition to break his maiden. His other win was in an allowance at Delaware Park. We talked about that Sir Barton a little bit earlier in the rundown. He was 8th in that race and 6th in the Gotham. Tough spot for this Uriah St. Louis long shot.
Yeah, and I think we could say the same about Who's the King, another long shot in here. But Who's the King, I tell you what, I really like Not This Time. Not This Time has become one of my recent favorite young sires out there. Turf, dirt, short, long, Not This Time, just a really good sire. And as Safi Joseph brings this horse in, finally broke his maiden in the maiden claimer 2 starts back. He won easy to do it. Last time wasn't so good, though, in a restricted allowance race. It seems like he's stepping up probably above his head here in the Ohio Derby.
Yeah, well, Safi Joseph Jr. is another one of those trainers that's not afraid to take a shot with a long price. I think he's sending other horses to Thistledown for this big day of racing. So I may as well put this one on the van. He claimed this one for $35,000 before he got that maiden win.
Yeah, might as well put this one on the van. That's probably not glowing endorsement there from Matt Shifman for the Ohio Derby chances of who's the king. Finally, we get to the number eight, the morning line favorite, Catching Freedom. I see 9-5 on the morning line. I think he's likely lower than that in here, Matt. Catching Freedom, a son of Constitution, trained by Brad Cox, has never run a bad race. And that includes some very big races this year. He's already won two stakes this year, be looking for his third stakes win, coming off of Preakness, where he was third, but didn't get a lot of pace to run at in the Preakness, but another good performance by Catching Freedom.
Yeah, and a fourth place in the Kentucky Derby, Brian. Two very good runs in the Triple Crown races. I guess maybe they considered the Belmont Stakes a little bit and opted to go in this Ohio Derby, not forgetting that Catching Freedom is the winner of the Louisiana Derby on the Derby Trail. Boy, Brian, on paper, he looks like a very worthy and probably tough to beat favorite. And I agree, 9-5 would be a big price for this horse.
Yeah, it's so good on paper, Matt, and one of the best three-year-olds in the country, honestly, if you look at all five of his races this year, including the Smarty Jones and the Risen Star, Oaklawn, Louisiana Fairgrounds, big Louisiana Derby win, good races in both the Derby and the Preakness, as you say. Catching Freedom just hasn't run a bad race. This is 5 weeks since the Preakness. Obviously, he's going well, the horse to beat in the Ohio Derby. The next horse on the list, Matt, and I'm going to pull up the Timeform U.S. pace projector now for this Ohio Derby. Again, this is 9 furlongs, $500,000. Grade three, I like it a little bit better than the average grade three. Number nine is Batten Down, and Batten Down, you'll see on the pace projector here, Matt, is one of the horses out there on the early pace. They're not saying slow, they're not saying fast, but he's involved, according to Timeform U.S., and their pace projector. And the two other horses that are also out there early, Who's the King, the 7, and Charleston, the 3, are big long shots. So that could be advantage for Batten Down, the best bred horse in the race, Matt. Tap It, out of the wonderful champion mare Close Hatches, makes him a full brother to some really nice graded stakes winners. Batten Down ran against good horses when he was 0-3 in his first three races of his career for trainer Belmont. But last time he got a 1.25 maiden race at Churchill Downs, a little bit unusual. And I think he showed his talent, his class, and a little bit of the fact that he might be getting good right about now.
Yeah, well, if that almost 9-length victory in that maiden race is an indication, then I certainly agree with you. If you are a pedigree aficionado, and I know there are plenty of them out there, you got to love Batten Down in this Ohio Derby, particularly with 8-1 morning line odds.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned the morning line odds. I guess I've been a critic of it, and I don't mean to be too much of a critic, but I'm just being honest. I think Catching Freedom is lower than 9-5. I think Copper Tax is not the second choice, the 7-2 morning line shot. And I just can't see Batten Down at 8-1 in here. Batten Down is going to get bet more than 8-1. Junior Alvarado again on the son of Tappet here. He will be in that race for second choice in my eyes. So Batten Down might be the most dangerous competition in my eyes to Catching Freedom, because you don't see maidens run 2.02 very often, Matt, and that's what he did in that 1.25 race at Churchill Downs. He could be a good one. They thought about the Belmont for Batten Down, and they decided again to take a more reasonable approach in his career this early in his career, and they decided on the Ohio Derby. They didn't find an easy spot in the Ohio Derby, but Batten Down certainly a horse to watch the second half of the year. We could see something good it's just not going to be at 8-1. The 10 horse is the horse who's supposed to be the farthest back on that time form U.S. pace projector. Mugatu has run in some good races, but hasn't really been a threat. Last time he was eased on that wet track in the Preakness.
Yes, a lot of stakes experience, Brian, is one thing if we want to put a positive twist on it. But boy, he really hasn't done particularly well. A little bit better in some of the other races. I guess fifth in the Bluegrass is an okay performance. Fourth in the Battaglia at Turfway Park, yeah, another okay performance. But like you said, this is no soft field here. Plenty of experienced stakes horses. Tough spot for this horse coming from the 10 post.
Yeah, agreed. His best race of his life was certainly the fifth place finish in the Bluegrass two starts back, and then he got a wet track and off track in the Preakness. So that's something if you're looking to hang your hat on Mugatu is a long shot in here, but I don't think either Matt or I are real high in his chances. Several other stakes. You got the Cleveland Gold Cup. You got Ohio bred stakes races aplenty on Saturday at Thistledown. But then you got the Lady Jacqueline. The Lady Jacqueline's become a pretty good stakes race for older female dirt runners the last few years. And this year we got no superstars, honestly, in this $250,000 stakes race, also at 9 furlongs. It's the race before the Ohio Derby. So Matt and I are going to take a look at that field. Matt, I guess we got a field of 10 here, and we got a mixture of local horses in the Lady Jacqueline, as well as some out-of-towners. I think favoritism is going to probably come down to 2 or 3 horses, but a pretty wide-open field. Let me see if this graphic will work on my end here. I'm going to try to get the Lady Jacqueline back up. It didn't show up for me. I don't know if it did for you, Matt. There it is. All right. Let's work from the rail out. We'll go a little bit quicker with this field. Safi Joseph, again, has a horse who, a daughter of Union Rags, who I guess you can look at a little bit. She's coming off a nice win last time at Gulfstream Park. But I see the odds of that race. She was 3-10. So that makes me feel like she didn't really beat anybody. Still, you got to respect Safi Joseph. Luis Saez will be on this mare on Saturday.
Yeah, Safi's horses frequently run really well at his home base of Gulfstream Park. But yeah, big win in that allowance race at Gulfstream. But again, I agree, that was probably against pretty soft competition.
Absolutely. I do take a second look for the trainer and the jockey, but probably not for me in this spot. Magic Palace is a mare out of Palace Malice, one of the horses I used to love back in the day. But she looks cheaper. Last time she was handled pretty easily locally by Red Hot Lass, a long shot for sure.
Yeah, that's for sure. Certainly going to be a long shot. A second and a third. In allowances most recently at Thistledown.
Yeah, another one who has some experience and some good experience at Thistledown is Dot Marie. She's actually 3-3. Whenever she tries better horses, though, she doesn't do that well. In fact, her last two, she was 7th and 7th when she ventured east and ran against good horses. I think she's found good horses here in the Lady Jacqueline.
Yeah, I think so. Again, she actually ran not too long ago in that that Belmont Racing Festival, which was run at Saratoga, and also ran in a stakes race at Laurel, both times finishing 7th.
Yeah, Ways and Means beat her in that Saratoga allowance race by a pole last time. Next horse is interesting to me, Frosty O'Toole, a daughter of Frosted, another one of my favorites. Rocco Bowen will be in the saddle here. This looks like a race with some speed, and Frosty O'Toole can rally. She hasn't got it done against this class before, but if you look at the last race at Monmouth, she wasn't that far back from some very nice mares in the Serena Song.
Yeah, it was a good field in that Serena Song at Monmouth Park, where she ended up 4th, had a 2nd in an allowance at Oaklawn Park the time before that. It looks like we have the main contenders in this race, Brian, lined up consecutively in the starting gate.
Yeah, if you're watching the Olympic trials in the swimming, as I've been doing the last few nights, you'll see that they put the top qualifiers right in the middle of the pool, and that's kind of what we got here in the Lady Jacqueline. Number five is Musical Mischief. Could be a tepid favorite in here for trainer Michael McCarthy. She ran some good races against some good horses in California. She was second last time, Preakness weekend in the DuPont. Her last win was a few starts back, but it was an 11 and a half length romp at Churchill Downs, an allowance race last fall. She is a filly that I think might have some upside to her. Certainly one of the horses to beat in this race.
Yeah, and you know, on these horses, these next three or four horses that we're talking about, we're going to look and we're going to find some pretty good performances in their past performances. Nothing that makes them a standout, and this Musical Mischief is another one of them, with that second place in the DuPont Stakes at Pimlico recently.
Yeah, and I really like her turf race late last year when she was third to a top filly named Anisette in the American Oaks. Musical Mischief, an interesting horse. Again, she should be one of the ones vying for favoritism. I think Misty Vale will also be vying for favoritism. Mike Maker's good with these older horses, whether they be female or male. And Misty Vale qualifies. She's a six-year-old. She's been around for a while. She's running a lot of stakes races, a lot of graded stakes races. She hits on occasion. She's 7 of 37. One thing I don't like about Misty Vale, I'll tell you one thing I like first. I'll be an optimist before I'm a pessimist. One thing I like about Misty Vale is that she can come from off the pace. And I said I do expect a pretty good pace in here, and that could be an advantage for Ramon Vasquez on Misty Vale. One thing I don't like about Misty Vale is she came to this race last year, and she was pretty well beaten fourth. That might have been a little bit tougher edition of the Lady Jacqueline, but it makes me wonder how much she likes this Thistledown track, Matt.
Yeah, and Misty Vale, you know, another one where we're going to look for the good performances. Last time, eighth place in the Apple Blossom, and yeah, that was a tough group for sure. But she was pretty outclassed in there. So if you're going to like Misty Vale, you're gonna have to look beyond that and look back to races like the Azari, where Misty Vale was second to that really special mare Adair Manor, who has won so many races, and then in that Azari at Oaklawn Park, and before that was third in another good race there, the Bayakoa. Are those performances enough to be a win contender in this Lady Jacqueline field? Maybe.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. She didn't run very well in the Grade One Apple Blossom last time, but three straight stakes races. She won the Pippin as well. Three straight stakes races at Oakland before that Apple Blossom, that Grade One Apple Blossom. She was very good, and that's why she could be the favorite here. She's also a winner of $750,000 over her career. So the top overall credentials of the field. Another horse I think that's got to get money in here is the Indiana bred Corningstone. McPeak and Brian Hernandez Jr. again. Corningstone looked good beating Indiana Breds this time last year. And she's been a little bit hit or miss, but it seemed like she was rallying by the field at Indiana last year. And she showed more speed in some of these races that she's been beaten in open company. Last time they took her off the pace just a little bit, and she really came through with a nice allowance win at Churchill Downs. I like that performance going in to this Lady Jacqueline for the daughter of Cantheros. Again, an Indiana bred, Matt.
Yeah, and one of the few horses in this field that is coming into this race off of a quality victory at a better track with that allowance win at Churchill Downs. And we mentioned how Kenny McPeak is going as of late. also has a fifth place in an allowance at Oakland Park, a third going back a few more races in the Houston Lady Stakes, which is a grade three. So again, another one, if you look, you can find some good things to consider for Corningstone.
Yeah, that Oakland Park allowance was not so good because she faded. And again, I'm hoping that she can come from off the pace just a little bit. Having said that, let's take a look at the time form U.S. pace projector for the Lady Jacqueline here, the 9-furlong Lady Jacqueline. They're talking about a fast pace, and they have some Ohio horses out there, Red Hot Lass, notably, we haven't talked about yet on the far outside. Corningstone is involved, but again, I'd like to see her just a little bit off like she was last time. And then number one, the Safi Joseph mare, Batacuda, on the rail, but could be a pretty lively pace here. As we talked about, another one that I think could even be involved in that pace, time form U.S. pace projector doesn't necessarily agree with me, is the number eight, Key to Success. Key to Success, Matt, is coming off two straight sprint wins, 6-furlong wins over the track.
Yeah, two allowance wins in her last two starts at Thistledown. Yeah, you're going to think, you know, the best thing for them to do is probably to send the horse.
Yeah, I think she might be a little bit more involved, but there could be, as we just saw, many mares, fillies and mares involved early in the Lady Jacqueline. Number nine, if you're looking for a long shot, Yankee Dollar, you could do worse than Yankee Dollar, daughter of California Chrome. She's a stakes winner in Arizona this year on turf and dirt, a well-traveled daughter of California Chrome. She's got pretty good form. Her form is getting better with age, and Turf Paradise again. You know, she'll have to prove it against a tougher field here, but not out of the question for Yankee Dollar.
Yeah, from a trainer that we've heard the name of in the past, Marcus Vitale. I had wondered where he might be training. So this one comes from Turf Paradise, was third in a stakes race on the turf. That was against the boys, interestingly. And before that, won another turf stakes race. At Turfway Park, yeah, shipping a ways to get to the Ohio Derby, tough spot.
Tough spot, but again, a mare I can't completely throw out as she moves up in class, and she was on the eastern half of the country before in her successful run out in Arizona. Of the local horses, certainly you have to look at Red Hot Lass as the one to beat of the Ohio mares. Red Hot Lass has won 5 out of 8 lifetime starts at Thistledowns. She faded to fifth in this race last year. Again, I think this might be a little bit tougher last year than it was than it will be on Saturday. Red Hot Lass, you can't throw out, and she's coming off a nice win locally at Thistledown.
Yeah, the locals, are going to like Red Hot Lass coming into the race with 3 wins in a row.
3 wins in a row for Red Hot. Well, she's a Red Hot Lass, man. I promise I won't say any more jokes on the show. And the show is almost over, so I won't have any trouble telling any bad jokes here. Hey, let's get to our top picks from these two headliners at Thistledown on Saturday. We'll start with the Ohio Derby, the big one, and we'll start with you first, Matt.
Okay, Brian. Hey, you know, good field, interesting horses who have done some good things. I think there are 6 horses in this field that have made an appearance on the Kentucky Derby trail recently. But certainly it's Catching Freedom, who has to catch your eye, has done the best in the Kentucky Derby trail with that win in the Louisiana Derby, and then the 3rd in the Preakness, and the 4th in the Kentucky Derby. Everything points to Catching Freedom. I just don't like anybody else enough in this field that's going to be more of a price. I have to make Catching Freedom, on pure class and performance, my top pick.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm with you, Matt. I picked Catching Freedom in the Louisiana Derby. I picked him in the Preakness. I'm not getting off Catching Freedom here. I think this is a spot where he should shine against lesser competition, much like Two Phils did recently in the Ohio Derby. I think the horses he has to beat are Batten Down and Gould's Gold. Those are the two that I think are most dangerous to him in the Ohio Derby. But this will be a race where I look for exotics, whether it be multi-race or getting horses underneath Catching Freedom, because I think he's a likely favorite that wins the Ohio Derby. And the Lady Jacqueline, Matt?
Lady Jacqueline, we've got those three or four horses that are pretty evenly matched. So I think they're going to be pretty close in odds. I'm going to go with Misty Vale, that second place finish in the Azari, beaten by a narrow margin by Adair Manor, caught my eye. So if I feel like if Misty Vale can run back to that, she's got a good shot.
Yeah, Misty Vale certainly one of the ones. I'm going with Corningstone. McPeak and Hernandez have been hot this year, as you've mentioned. Corningstone, though, is another one that I think could be moving forward this year. Indiana Bred, who did good things against her fellow state breds last year, but I really like her win at Churchill Downs last time for the daughter of Canthero. So that's my top pick. Before we go, Matt, how about a parting shot from you? Who, by the way, didn't you go to college in Ohio?
I did, Brian. Not far from Thistledown, so I did make a few trips out to Thistledown back in the day. So a race with the title of like the Cleveland Cup just makes my heart skip a little bit. Great day at Ohio Derby on HorseCenter here. We'd like to recognize other tracks on their big days, the signature day of racing at Thistledown. So take a look at it this weekend, HorseCenter fans. And as always, thanks for watching our show.
Well said, Matt. Thank you to all who watch. Go ahead and subscribe now to our YouTube channel here at Horse Racing Nation. Turn on those notifications so you always know when Horse Center is hitting. And don't be afraid to leave us a comment. We get positive comments. We get negative comments. We get somewhere in between. We read them all. We appreciate it. Special thanks, of course, to Candace Curtis for the race graphics, to our friend there in the home office in Louisville, Derby Wars, our sponsor, the best contest site out there. And thank you to Timeform US for use of their pace projectors right here on HorseCenter. Next week, Matt, we'll be talking about a big card from Louisville, Kentucky, Stephen Foster Day. The Stephen Foster is looking to be shaping up as the first huge race of the summer. And they'll have a big card at Stephen Foster at Churchill Downs next week. So that's what we'll have for you next week on HorseCenter. Until then, good luck. We'll see you soon right here on HorseCenter.